the 7 days over. You have now 3 more days left to work. But to work seriously, you have only 2 more days left. Because 10th day, after the sitting from 8 to 9, you will learn a new technique of meditation. And after that, the vow of silence is over. Noble silence, no more noble silence, it will be noble chattering then. Chattering is chattering, noble or not noble. Chattering and serious meditation cannot coexist. They can't go together. So you won't be able to meditate seriously on the 10th day. And yet it is a very important day. Very important day, because for 9 days, very deep operation, very deep surgical operation of the mind. On the 10th day, this deep wound will require some balm. And the technique that you will learn on that day will be a very soothing balm on the wound. And moreover, coming out of a very deep operation, coming out of silence for 9 days, suddenly one comes to the outside world, comes in contact. At times, people have very shocking experience. So that 10th day is a shock absorber for you. On the 11th day, you can face the world better. So for actual very serious meditation, the next 2 days. And Buddha wants you to meditate continuously. So far as this technique is concerned, continuity of practice is the secret of success. People come for longer courses, 20 days course, 30 days, 45 days. They work continuously. You have recess periods, but there is no recess period for long-term students. You also have to learn how to practice continuously. So for these 2 days, learn how to practice continuously. During meditation periods, of course, you sit with closed eyes and meditate. But what you call intervals are no more intervals for you now. When you have to do something at the physical level, you have to get up and walk, walk to your residence, walk to the dining hall, etc. You are still meditating. With open eyes, you are aware. You are just resting. Open eyes, you are aware. You are aware of whatever you are doing at the physical level. If you are walking, you are aware, you are walking. If you are eating, you are aware, you are eating. If you are bathing, you are aware, you are bathing. You are resting, you are aware, you are resting. But then along with that, very essential, you are also aware of some sensation or the other on the body. People have not understood Buddha properly, and they made it just awareness of walking, 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 eating. It has its own advantage, but this is not Buddha's teaching. He wants you to be always aware of the sensation, either respiration or sensation. If you miss sensation, then you miss the deepest part of your mind. And you have to rectify the deepest part of the mind. You have to change the behavior pattern of the deepest part. So sensation, awareness of sensation is very important. While you are walking, it is not necessary, and at this stage not possible also, that you can feel the whole body, sensation on the whole body, at least on the moving part. If you are walking, you are aware of sensations on your legs. If you are eating, you are aware of sensations on your fingertips. The mouth touches the food, you are aware of the sensation on the lips, on the gums, on the tongue, and as you swallow it, on the throat. Whichever are moving part, you have sensations. Sometimes you don't feel sensation on the moving part, that, and then any part. But somewhere on the body you must be feeling a sensation, and along with that you are aware of whatever physical activity is going on. That is during recess periods. Then you have a continuity. Meditation hours, you sit, close the eyes, meditate. The rest of the period you open and do whatever is necessary to be done at the physical level, and you are still meditating because you are aware of your activities and you are aware of the sensations. Night time you go to bed, closed eyes, you are lying down. Lying down, you are aware of every movement of your body. You feel like turning on one side and you are aware you are turning on the one side, and then you turn on the other side. You are aware of everything that is happening at the physical level. Along with that, you are aware of sensations. Not necessary, again, to move from head to feet in order or feet to head in order. You are lying down. Any sensation arises anywhere, you are aware. So some sensation or the other, anywhere on the body. And as you are aware of sensation, you get sleep, deep sleep, very good. Night is for deep sleep. Next day morning, as you awaken, you feel sensations. Again, you start with the sensations. Quite possible at times, a serious student may not get a deep sleep. Half asleep, half awakened, very good. And in some cases, whole night no sleep. Wonderful. Whole night no sleep. But you keep lying down, closed eyes, no sleep, doesn't matter, and you are aware of sensation, aware of sensation. If you start worrying, oh look, no sleep. 12 o'clock, no sleep. 1 o'clock, no sleep. 2 o'clock, no sleep. The next day you come up as a sick person. You are not practicing Vipassana. But you are just aware of your sensation. If no sensation, aware of respiration. Whole night. And the mind is very equanimous. Next day you get up so fresh. As if you have come out of very deep sleep. Very deep sleep. After all, nature wants you to sleep only for two purposes. One purpose is to give rest to the body. Whole day the body has been working, now give rest. Similarly, whole day the mind was busy here, there, give rest to the mind. So night time, never sit and meditate. Keep lying. So you get full rest to the body. You give full rest to the body and mind gets wonderful rest when it is awakened, aware, and at the same time equanimous. It gets so much rest. So the purpose is served, the body gets full rest, the mind gets full rest. Next day, you are very fresh, very fresh. There are, in all the Indian scriptures, three kinds of situations are there. Either one is awakened, or one is in sleep, or one is in dream. But there is a fourth situation for the yogis. Yogis does not mean those who do these acrobatic exercises of asana and pranayama. They are not yogis. Yogi is one who attains communion with the ultimate truth. Is a yogi, Vipassana yogi. Now that is a stage which is a very high stage. You are awakened not as a sick person. You are awakened with the reality of the sensations within you and keeping your mind perfectly equanimous, perfectly equanimous. That is why in many of the scriptures it is said the entire world sleeps but the yogi remains awakened, awakened in this sensations, the reality inside. This does not mean that night time you are getting sleep and you say, I won't sleep, I am a Vipassana yogi. That the world sleep, I will remain awakened, that is going to extreme. If naturally you feel like sleeping, sleep. But if you don't get sleep and you are aware of sensations, you are equanimous, no worry, don't have any anxiety. You are doing your job. You are just aware of the reality at the level of sensations and you are not reacting. You are equanimous. You are given full rest to the mind. You are given full rest to the body. Like this, make use of these remaining 2 days. Learn how to practice Rattindiva Matanditu. As Buddha says, day and night. Only when you are in deep sleep, you can't help. Otherwise, day and night, continuous. Make a very deep surgical operation. So that in these 2 days, you take out very deep-rooted complexes, which are causes for great misery for you. Let them come out now. This is a wonderful time to get liberated from those complexes, and continuity will help you. Storms might come still, but now, having covered 7 days, you have strength to face. You are strong enough to face them. Don't worry. No such storm will come which will make you very much agitated. Those five enemies, five Nivaranas, are still there, but they are becoming weaker, weaker, weaker. And you have got five friends also, wonderful friends. Keep them with you, and you will find that these friends are so helpful to you. These friends are really helpful, provided their purity is maintained. When they lose their purity, these very friends become our enemies, and they become very harmful. Who are our friends? What is their purity? Let us understand. Five friends we have. The first friend, in the language of those days, was called Saddha, that means devotion, faith. Devotion, faith, is a very important friend. One who does not have any faith, any devotion in whatever one is working, then how can one work? All the time doubtful, skeptical, then one cannot work. Must have confidence, must have faith. Now, 7 days are over. By this time, one should have faith in the technique, on the path, and can work much better. But this faith, this confidence, this devotion can become a very big enemy if it becomes blind. Blind faith, blind devotion, blind belief does not help us. They are big enemies. Don't allow them to become blind. All these five friends, if they become blind, they are useless. They don't help us in any way. So along with this, there must be wisdom. Every friend must have the wisdom with it, so that you understand the purity of this particular friend. The devotion, purity of devotion, is only when you have wisdom with devotion. Without wisdom, it will become blind. The wisdom is like our eyes, and devotion is like our legs. One who does not have eyes will walk on the path, may even run on the path, but will not know when he or she has taken wrong path. One may fall down in a ditch because no eyes. One has only eyes and no legs, no devotion. One will keep on looking the path. Oh, wonderful path, so wonderful, so great. Buddha's teaching is so wonderful, Dhamma is so wonderful. But you can't take one step on that because you have no devotion, you've got no faith. Both are important. The communion of these two, that gives us so much strength, because then the devotion becomes enlightened devotion. A devotion with discriminatory intelligence, discriminatory wisdom, then you know what is the essence of devotion. You don't take it just blindly. What is the essence of devotion? You may have devotion in anyone, in any god, goddess, a saintly person, an enlightened person. Why you have devotion in this person, in this being? Because this person is a saintly person, he has certain qualities, and the devotion is towards the qualities. You get inspiration seeing those qualities, and then you get an inspiration to develop those very qualities in you. Then the devotion is very helpful, very purposeful. Otherwise it doesn't help. If you just make devotion with a begging bowl, you keep on asking, oh God Almighty, please give me this. Oh Goddess, please give me this. This desire must be fulfilled, that desire must be fulfilled. That kind of devotion is blind devotion. It does not help. Devotion for the qualities and getting inspiration and developing those very qualities is a wonderful devotion. An instance, again years back, during the early courses I gave in India, coming from Burma, a very old lady came to a course, took the course very seriously, worked very seriously, understood the technique properly, worked properly, and got wonderful results. Going back home for 1 year, she continued to practice morning and evening, continued to apply this technique in daily life, and again she got much more benefits. After 1 year, she came again to get established more and more in the technique in Dhamma. But she had an interview with me and then told me that she has got one fear in her mind. What fear? She says she comes from the bhakti cult, the cult of devotion. And this is Gyan Marg. Gyan Marg means the path of wisdom. Although this will take to the final goal, I understand. But I fear I don't want to get out of my bhakti cult, my devotion. That must remain. And I fear by this technique, I will miss my bhakti, my devotion. And I tell her, oh no, don't worry. Your bhakti, your devotion will become stronger. Oh no, no sir. With this kind of technique, there is no place for bhakti, no place for devotion. And she won't understand. I told her, all right, do you really have faith in your God or your Goddess? Do you really have confidence? Do you really have devotion? She said, what, sir? Traditionally, we are in this cult of bhakti. We have got so much of devotion, so much of faith, so much of confidence in this God or that Goddess. Then I questioned her, do you make promissory offerings? Back in India, it's very common. Promissory offering. What is a promissory offering? Say somebody is sick in the family. The head of the family, the mother or father, will go to the temple, bow down to that God or Goddess, and then say, please cure my son or daughter, whoever. And when she or he is cured, I will offer you sweets, 5 rupees worth of sweets. Do you make such promissory offerings? Oh, certainly, this is very common. Then you don't have faith in your God. You don't have faith in your Goddess. First you must cure your son or daughter. Then only you offer 5 rupees. You don't have even 5 rupees worth of faith in your God or Goddess. You won't offer this 5 rupees worth of sweet earlier. First you must cure my son or daughter. A commercial bhakti, commercial devotion. You give first and then you take. Give and take. This is no devotion, blind devotion. Doesn't help. And this is what happens in the name of devotion. You always expect something. This God should do something for me. That Goddess should do something for me. This enlightened person must do something for me. This saintly person may do something for me. Always expecting something is no purity of the bhakti. Someone says that he's a great bhakta, great devotee of Rama. Wonderful to be a devotee of Rama. A person of so much good qualities. You remember those qualities and try to imbibe those qualities in your life. It's a wonderful bhakti. But one does not do that. Rama, the quality of Rama, you might have heard his story, life story. He was the eldest son. And father decided, because he had given a promise to the youngest wife, youngest queen, and the youngest queen wanted her son to become the heir to the throne. So, however unwillingly, he decided that Rama should go in the jungle, get banished for 14 years, and the youngest son, Bharata, should get the throne. Very willingly. He leaves the kingdom very, very willingly. Let my younger brother enjoy all the luxuries of the royal palace. I'll be quite happy. I'll be happy in jungle. And he goes. Father dies. And the younger brother, who was not present at that time, came. And when he came to know of all this, he was shocked. He is the real heir to the throne, not I. And he goes all the way to the jungle and tells him, no, sir. No, brother, you must go back to the capital. You are the owner of the throne, owner of the crown. In your place, I will stay in jungle. the father made a wrong decision. He didn't make the decision in wisdom. And the elder brother says, Rama says, oh no, no, this is the order of the father. You must enjoy all the luxuries of the royal life. Two brothers, throughout the human history, you got no other example where two brothers are fighting, quarreling. You must enjoy all the royal luxury. Such a wonderful person, Rama. And one says that I am a devotee of Rama. Two brothers, they claim they are great devotees of Rama. And both of them are fighting, quarreling, having civil suits and criminal suits or what? When our property was divided, you got a few dollars more on here. And you got a few inches of land more. So we are quarreling. And yet they call, they are great devotees of Rama. Great devotees of Rama. Poor Rama, if he is somewhere above the clouds, he will be shedding tears. What kind of devotees I have? They don't want to take any inspiration from the qualities that I have. They don't want to live a life that I lived. And yet they call themselves devotees, my devotees. Madness, such kind of devotion does not help. Does not help. And then Rama, he is taken as God Almighty. Incarnation of God Almighty. See what we have made of poor God Almighty. We have devalued him. What a great devaluation. Somebody writes the name of Rama on the forehead, Rama on his arms, Rama on his chest, and wears the upper cloth printed Rama, 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 so that the Rama should know that I am such a great devotee of Rama. As if Rama is very fond to hear his name, every now and then his name. People should keep on reciting his name. If he is the creator of the world, he should have created people only reciting Rama, Rama, nothing else. Because he's so fond of these words. If he's really fond of only his name, then what an ego-centered person he is. What a self-centered person. It is said that God created human beings in his own image. But I feel otherwise. Human beings created God in their own image, according to their own liking. We want such a God. And we keep on reciting his name, he gets puffed up. Then whatever we do, right or wrong, we will get all the benefits and he will give us this benefit or that benefit. This kind of God we create. Our own imagination, our own creation. For example, if there is a Goenka, mad Goenka, who is very fond of his name, every day people should talk about Goenka, 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 on the radio, Goenka, Goenka. On the TV, Goenka, Goenka, on the newspaper, Goenka, Goenka, and people build temples of Goenka and establish statues of Goenka and then start dancing, Hare Goenka, Hare Goenka. And this Goenka gets puffed up, wonderful. Such a mad Goenka. When he creates an imaginary God, he will create a God of that type who will get puffed up by hearing his name. What we have done, poor God, if he exists, poor God, we have so much devalued him. This is what happens when the devotion becomes blind devotion. You forget to get inspiration from the qualities and you forget to inspire with this inspiration to develop those qualities in you, then devotion is harmful. Someone says, I am a great devotee of Jesus Christ. Oh, wonderful, such a saintly person. A prince among the saints, so saintly. Whether someone is really saintly or not, the yardstick is at the time of death what kind of mind this person is carrying and what kind of mind he was carrying. He was tortured to death, crucified. Being tortured, he has not a trace of anger or aversion or hatred towards those people who are torturing him. Only love, only compassion. They don't know what they are doing. Ignorant people. May they not be punished for their bad deeds. They are so ignorant. Only love, only compassion. A real saintly person. If someone says that I am a devotee of Jesus Christ and does not develop even little bit of love and compassion and goodwill for others, then this devotion is blind devotion. Someone comes to me and says that I am a devotee of Jesus Christ because I accept that he was son of the God. So what? He was son of the God. As if he wants a testimonial from you. And then he will be very happy. Well, look, these people, they give me, so many people give me testimonial, I am son of the God. And what sort of Christ is Christ? We are mad, what we are doing? Is there any doubt that he was son of the God? He was son of the God. After all, what is God? Truth is God. Love is God. Compassion is God. Purity is God. And here is a product of truth, of love, of compassion, of goodwill, of purity. He is a product of that. He is son of God. Those qualities are important. And if we try to develop those very qualities in us, then yes, we are good devotees of Jesus Christ. Otherwise, no, it becomes a blind faith, blind devotion. Does not work. Someone says, I am a devotee of Buddha. Ah, wonderful to be a devotee of Buddha. Have devotion towards Buddha. Fully enlightened person, liberated person. But again, if the devotion becomes blind devotion, then early morning somebody with folded hands will say, Buddhang Saranam Gacchami, I take refuge in Buddha, I take refuge in Buddha, I take refuge in Buddha. 3 times, I have taken refuge in Buddha. Now I am free for the whole day to do whatever I like. I get open general license for doing anything. After all, why I took refuge in Buddha? So that he can liberate me in spite of all my bad deeds. He should liberate me. Otherwise, why I take refuge in Buddha? Madness. Not understood. What does he mean? What does he mean when he asks people to take refuge in Buddha? Quality, enlightenment. Take refuge in enlightenment. And take refuge in enlightenment means develop enlightenment in you. Your own enlightenment is going to give you refuge. No one else will give you protection. No one else. You have to take refuge in your enlightenment, develop that quality. And then yes, there is a purpose in saying that I take refuge in Buddha. Otherwise it becomes a blind devotion. Blind devotion. He is not interested to establish a sect. He doesn't want more and more people to say, I take refuge in Buddha and have a bigger sect. Nothing doing. He is interested, full of compassion, to see people that they come out of their misery. They belong to this sect or that sect makes no difference. People of this community or that community makes no difference. Of this country or that country makes no difference. This gender or that gender makes no difference. Suffering is there. And enlightenment of Buddha is, he gives a path. Because of his enlightenment, he found out the path, which made him enlightened. And out of all the compassion, he gives that path. If you don't walk on the path, the devotion is no devotion. It doesn't work. When we give respect to Buddha, he teaches us how to pay respect to Buddha. Buddha is not a name of any person. It's the quality. Enlightened one. And anyone can be an enlightened person, not merely Gautama. This is not the monopoly of one person to become enlightened. He kept on saying that before me, there were countless Buddhas. And after me, there will be countless Buddhas. So when you pay respect to Buddha, he taught us how to pay respect to Buddha. Ye cha Buddha atita cha ye cha Buddha yanagata. All the Buddhas of the past, Atita. All the Buddhas of the future. Pachupanna chaye Buddha. All the Buddhas who are now present maybe. Aham vandami sabbada. I pay respect to all the Buddhas of the past, of the future, of the present. Then you not get entangled yourself in a sect. In an organized religion. Then you get inspiration from the enlightenment, the quality of enlightenment, and try to develop that enlightenment in you. Whenever you pay homage to Buddha, he explained us how to pay homage to Buddha. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa. I pay homage to anyone who has these qualities, namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa, who is fully liberated, fully enlightened, and enlightened by his own efforts, to such a person, I pay homage. You pay respect. We say you do puja. There is a puja which is called Samish puja, impure puja. You have image of Buddha and you offer incense and flowers and sweets and bow down and you say, I am doing puja of Buddha. No. Niramish puja. And what is Niramish puja? Pure puja. And he says, Dhammanu dhamma patipattiya buddhaṁ pujemi. I do the puja of Buddha, that means I pay respect to Buddha, by walking on the path of Dhamma. From the grossest to the subtlest, you start with sila, the grossest part of Dhamma. Then you proceed to samadhi, subtler than that. You proceed to panya, subtler than that. And you transcend that also and experience nibbana, the subtlest ultimate reality. This is how you pay respect to Buddha. Dhammanu dhamma patipattiya buddhaṁ pujemi. So teaching the Dhamma must be very well understood. The having respect for somebody, having devotion towards somebody, should not make it, one should not make it a blind devotion, otherwise it does not work. Similarly, having respect for Buddha, one must keep on remembering the quality of Buddha. What are the qualities of Buddha? And these are the qualities of Buddha. Iti piso bhagava arahaṁ sammā sambuddho vijya charana sampanno sugato lokavidu anuttaro purisa dhamma sarathi sattha deva manussānaṁ buddho bhagavāti. Iti piso bhagava. He is a Bhagavan. What Bhagavan? In 25 centuries, India has lost the meaning of this word Bhagavan. Now there are Bhagavans like monsoon frogs here and there, everywhere Bhagavan. Everybody claims, I am a Bhagavan. What Bhagavan? 25 centuries back, what was Bhagavan? Bhagga raguti bhagava, bhagga dosoti bhagava, bhagga mohoti bhagava. One who has destroyed all the raga, craving, all the aversion, dosha, and all the ignorance, illusion, delusion, moha, lives in the glory of liberation, is a Bhagava. So unless all these impurities are eradicated, to call oneself Bhagava is wrong. And Buddha is a Bhagava, a Bhagavan. You get inspiration to develop those qualities little by little. You are coming out of raga, you are coming out of dosha, you are coming out of moha, craving, aversion, ignorance. Then you are really paying respect to Buddha. You have got devotion towards Buddha. Arahaṁ. Again, old language of India. Ari means enemies. Hung, one was killed. Killed all the enemies. Oh, an apostle of non-violence, how can he kill anybody? And yet he has killed all his enemies. And who are our enemies? No outsider being is our enemy. Our own impurities are our enemies. One who has killed all the impurities, not a trace of defilement in the mind, has become an arahant, has killed all the enemy. Samma, sambuddho, he has become fully enlightened by his own efforts. Everyone has to become fully enlightened by one's own efforts. One does not make effort and expect some supernatural power, some invisible power to make you enlightened. Has not understood what Buddha is. Samma, sambuddho. Each has to work out one's own salvation, get one's own enlightenment by one's own efforts. Iti piso bhagava arahaṁ samma sambuddho vijja charana sampanno. One is perfect in vijja and perfect in acharan. That means in practice as well as the theory. One understands dharma at the highest level, vijja, the wisdom, and then applies it in the life. This is the quality of Buddha. Yatha vadi, tatha kari, yatha kari, tatha vadi. Whatever he speaks, he practices in life. Whatever he practices, that much only he speaks, nothing more than that. And that is why he is called tatha gata, one who has walked on the path of personal experience of the truth, 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 has reached the ultimate goal of ultimate truth. If we say that we are devotees of Buddha, we have to follow that. Step by step, with the truth, with the truth, vijja charana sampanno. sugato. Every step taken by this person is right step. At the physical level or vocal level or mental level, he can't do anything that will harm others. We also try to develop that quality in us. Every step of ours, every action of ours should go for the good of others, not to harm others. Loka vidu. One has realized the truth of the entire universe within the framework of the body. We also start taking steps to experience the truth of the entire universe within the framework of the body. Whole life, one who keeps on serving people, so much of compassion. He becomes enlightened at the age of 35 and passes away at the age of 80, 45 years, day and night, serving people, suffering all around. People are so miserable. He finds out a wonderful technique, a wonderful path, and out of compassion, he keeps on serving, day and night. Hardly 2 to 3 hours he will sleep, and that also just lying down with the awareness and with wisdom. Rest of the time, serving. Whole life kept on serving people. Now it is 80th year. And 3 months before he passes away, he announces that after 3 months, I will leave this body. Where I should live? At that time he was in the eastern part of India somewhere. And he decides to go to Kushinagar, a big city in the middle of the northern part of India. And he has reached there. Now this full moon night, at the end of this full moon night, he will breathe his last. He is lying under a tree. His attendant Ananda is there to serve him. And suddenly, a thought comes in the mind of Ananda. Tomorrow morning, as the day breaks, he will be no more. And he has got thousands of people in this city who are his devotees. When they will come to know that he came so close to our city, this mad fellow Ananda didn't inform us, otherwise at least we would have seen him, paid respect while he was alive. So it is my duty, I must inform. He went to the city, just informed one or two, and then the word spread like a wildfire everywhere. People started coming in large number. Tomorrow morning, he will not be there. So we must pay respect while he is alive. Large number of people coming. Ananda doesn't know how to manage them. He requests them, please, come in a queue. So more and more people pay respect and go. First part of the night over. Middle part of the night over. Now the last part of the night is getting over. In a few minutes, he will breathe his last. Still there is such a big gathering. Somebody at the head of the queue, he doesn't move. He says, no, you want me just to go and pay respect to him? That body, what I will gain? I want to go to him to learn this wonderful technique from him. I know he's fully enlightened, he knows the technique. I don't know what you people will teach after he passes away. You may teach properly or not teach properly. While he's alive, I want to learn the technique. Ananda says, well, look, in a few minutes, he's going to breathe his last. This is not the time to teach you Dhamma. And he says, no. So all right, if you don't want to pay respect, leave the space for others. Let them come. And he neither moves nor goes himself. And these words reaches the ears of Buddha. Somebody has come to the Ganges to take a handful of water to quench the thirst. And people tell him, no, you can't quench your thirst. You can't take water. Just pay respect to Ganges and go away. Ganges starts overflowing. The Ganges of compassion starts overflowing. Ananda, allow him to come. He needs Dhamma. He's a proper person to be given Dhamma. He needs it. Send him. I will teach Dhamma. While breathing his last, he teaches Dhamma. At least one person should get. Not a single moment should go waste. Just serving people, without caring anything about his own discomfort, helping people, helping. If we develop even little bit of such compassion, such love, such goodwill, such selfless service, then there is meaning in saying that we are devotees of Buddha. Otherwise, it is just no purpose is served. Someone says that I take refuge in Dhamma. I got great devotion towards Dhamma, the teaching of Buddha. What Dhamma? Unless one understands what Dhamma and simply says, I take refuge in Dhamma, doesn't work. Take refuge in Dhamma. you live the life of Dhamma. You develop Dhamma in you. You develop Sila, Samadhi, Panya in you. Then there is purpose of your saying that I take refuge in Dhamma. Otherwise it is purposeless. It is senseless. And what Dhamma is? Dhamma is not a sect. Dhamma is not an organized religion. Dhamma is universal law, law of nature. If one has started living the life in line to the law of nature, then yes, one has taken refuge in Dhamma. And he explains what are the qualities of Dhamma. 6 qualities of Dhamma. One has to keep on understanding whether those qualities are there or not. Otherwise, in the name of Dhamma, one may get entangled in some kind of sect, belief, dogma, etc. What are the qualities of pure Dhamma? Swakhato Bhagavata Dhammo. Swakhato. It must be very clearly explained. No mysticism involved. No acrobatic intellectual exercises. Nothing doing. So simple. In so simple words it must be explained so that ordinary person can understand it because one has to follow it. Unless people understand. This is not the game of philosophers or scholars. This is something which people should understand and follow. That is why the first quality of Dhamma, Swakhato, Swakhato, Sandittiko. Then, whatever you are experiencing with your direct experience, the truth that you experience, then it is Dhamma. The truth experienced by an enlightened person is not truth for you. The truth as explained in the scriptures is not truth for you. The truth experienced by your teacher is not truth for you. What you experience, sandittiko, with your own eyes, with your own experience, direct experience, step by step, you may start with very gross truth, doesn't matter. This is your truth, your own experience, your own wisdom, and you keep on walking on the path with the truth, you are bound to experience subtler, subtler, subtler. The entire field of mind and matter, you experience the truth of mind and matter, and then transcend and experience something which is beyond mind and matter. Swakhato Bhagavata Dhammo Sandittiko Akaliko Akaliko. To get the fruits of your practice of Dhamma should not take time. Not that you practice Dhamma now and you will get benefit after death. You perform this rite, this ritual, this ceremony, and after that you will get this 7th heaven or 11th heaven. Who has come from 7th heaven to tell me that I have performed these rites and that's why I am in this 7th heaven? All purposeless, what you gain now. Of course, after death also you will get benefit. But what benefit you are getting now? If you are getting no benefit now, then it is no Dhamma. You have taken steps on Dhamma. You must get benefit of your having taken steps on Dhamma. Then only it is pure Dhamma, otherwise no Dhamma. Somebody gives me a post-dated check. Post-dated check on a bank above the clouds, which does not exist. What am I to do with this post-dated check? One must get benefit. Akaliko. There should not be a gap between my action and the fruit that I get. Akaliko. A change must start in the life. If you really started taking steps on the path, a change must start here and now, in this very life. A change for better. Ehi passiko. Another very important quality of Dhamma. If someone has really started taking steps on Dhamma, one has to judge, examine whether really it is Dhamma or not. Ehi pasyeko, which literal meaning is come, come and see yourself. Come and examine yourself. Come and experience yourself. Ehi pasyeko. People come to courses like this, some on the 4th day, some on the 5th day, some on the 6th day. They start thinking, oh, it is so wonderful. My mother should do it. My father should do it. So-and-so should do it. And suddenly you realize I am here to observe my respiration, my sensation. I will see about that later on. And again after some time you start thinking, oh, so-and-so, very miserable person. This person must certainly get it. This is ehi pasyeko. This is the quality of Dhamma. Because you are not playing an intellectual game. You are not playing a devotional or emotional game. You are actually experiencing something. Those who come to courses and say, the discourses were wonderful. What discourse is wonderful? The Dhamma was wonderful. If you just make it an intellectual entertainment, then no, it doesn't work. Because people come here and meditate. Because they meditate, they can't resist. When 10 days are over, one starts thinking, whomever one meets, oh, it is so wonderful, I have tasted, it is so good, it has helped me. You also go and try. You also go and try. This is the yardstick to measure whether one has certainly, surely tasted Dhamma or not. If one has really tasted Dhamma, one is bound to get some benefit. And when one gets benefit, one feels like sharing this benefit with others. If someone is a good writer, he feels like writing something so that more and more people know about it. People do not know that such a technique is prevailing, is being taught. If one is an orator, he will keep on talking here and there. If one is comfortable money-wise, will try to spend more and more money so that more and more people come and get advantage of it. Not that you want to enlarge in your sect. Now the small sect, let there be Vipassana sect, a bigger Vipassana sect. No, nothing doing. More and more people are miserable. If they come in contact with Dhamma, if they come in contact with this technique, they will come out of their misery, this love, this compassion. And then someone feels, well, when I went to a course, all the facilities were given to me because somebody has donated. Not only that, so many people selflessly were serving me. That's why I could meditate so peacefully, so comfortably. Oh, I must also give 10 days of my life. I must go and serve in one of the courses. And people come like this to give their service. Ehi pasyako, more and more people can get benefit of it. It is good when somebody gives a dana, a donation, because more people can get advantage of the facility. But it is much better if somebody gives a donation of service. You see, it is the volition that counts. When you are giving money, you are giving money for the liberation of people to come out of their misery. You give money to feed somebody. You give money to get water for somebody or some medicine for somebody. They are all good. But when you give money for the teaching of Dhamma, nothing like that. Your volition is that people come out of their misery, total misery. When you serve, when you give money, that moment, when you thought of this, you decided to donate money, was a good moment. Your volition was wonderful. When you actually gave money, your volition was wonderful. But when you serve for 10 days, continuously you are serving, and every time you are there, you feel good of others. Ah, look, so many people get Dhamma. Look, so many people are coming out of their misery. Continuously for 10 days, you are developing this parami, you are developing this volition, Dhamma volition. It is wonderful. People who have been giving such service, they find it. With my own experience, I know how I found it. When one starts giving service, one's own meditation becomes stronger and stronger. When you give food to somebody, the nature helps you that you will not starve. Similarly, when you give Dhamma to somebody, your Dhamma in return will become stronger and stronger. You get more Dhamma. So like this, people think of ehi pasyako, more and more. I serve more and more people, so that more and more people get Dhamma, more and more people get Dhamma. This is the quality, the yardstick, whether one has really practiced Dhamma or not. Opaneiko. If it is pure Dhamma, then every step that you take on the path takes you nearer and nearer to the final goal. Because the path is such, so clear. Like a highway, an autobahn, no curves here and there. Not that you enter a blind alley and then come back. Nothing doing. Every step takes you to the final goal. And that is opaneiko. Adime kalyanakari, madhyame kalyanakari, antame kalyanakari. It is beneficial in the beginning, beneficial in the middle, beneficial in the end. You practice only Shila and you start getting benefits. You practice Samadhi, more benefits. You practice Panya, much more benefits. You reach the final goal. Countless benefits you get. Every step that you take on the path gives result, good result. Not a single step, not a little effort that you make on the path of Dhamma goes waste. Nothing goes waste. And in this way it is called opaneiko. Pachattang veditabbo vinyuhiti. Pachattang, direct experience by everyone. When we belong to this sect or that sect, this community or that community, makes no difference. Dhamma is for all. Everyone can get benefit of Dhamma by practicing oneself. It is not that first you get converted in this particular organized religion, then this particular organized religion will start helping you. Nothing doing, then there is something wrong. Anybody, one may keep on calling oneself a Hindu, a Christian, a Jew, a Muslim, a Buddhist, makes no difference. Human being is human being. Out of ignorance, one keeps on generating craving, aversion, ignorance, and because of that one remains so very much agitated, so very much miserable. The path is there to take out the misery by taking out the impurities of the mind. So anyone can practice and will get the same result. Pachyattang veditabbu. It must be direct experience. If you play intellectual game, it doesn't work. The same teaching was there. The entire spectrum of the spirituality of India before Buddha, at the time of Buddha, and after Buddha remains the same. Come out of craving, come out of aversion, come out of illusion, delusion. Nothing new. Nothing new, but still so much new, because that is all at the intellectual level, at the emotional level. Here arose somebody who says at the actual level, how to come out of craving? Well, look, you observe your sensation. Your craving starts because of a pleasant sensation. Come out of aversion. Look at your sensation. Observe it. Whenever there is an unpleasant sensation, then only you start aversion. Really? At the practical level, somebody is teaching. And this is pachyattang veditabbu. At the level of Vedana, one has to understand the reality and come out of the misery. Vinyuhi. Any wise person can do this, can practice this. It is applicable to one and all. These are the qualities of Dhamma. Understanding these qualities, if one starts walking on the path, the benefit is bound to be there. Similarly, one says, I take refuge in Sangha. Not in any person, the quality of the person. Anybody who is walking on the right path, Supatipanno Bhagavato Savaka Sangho. Ujupatipanno Bhagavato Savaka Sangho. Nyaya patipanno bhagavato savaka sangho. Samichi patipanno bhagavato savaka sangho. Anyone who is walking on the right path, the correct path, the path of truth, the path of wisdom, and walking on the path, one has reached the stage where one has become a saintly person. Four stages of liberation. Out of them, at least first stage one has reached. And then only one is called a real sangha. Such a person, by seeing such a saintly person, one gets inspiration. And with this inspiration, one starts walking on the path. This is taking refuge in Sangha. The devotion is good devotion with the wisdom when one starts applying Dhamma in life. One starts developing the qualities in life. This is Saddha, the first important friend of ours. Second important friend, in the language of those days, it was called virya. Virya means effort. Again, proper effort. If you don't know how to make effort, you make effort in the wrong way and yet you don't get the result. Proper effort. What you have to do? There is a story back in our country, in India. In the city of Varanasi, a very ancient holy city of northern India, four friends, one moonlit night, they decided we better have boating for the whole night. And they took a boat. And Varanasi is Varanasi. It is a city of hashish, bhang, lot of smoking of bhang and drinking of bhang. And they had all that. And then in that boat, they started rowing, the whole night, rowing, perspiring, daybreak. And they saw their boat has not moved even an inch. It is where it was. What's wrong? And then someone found out. The rope by which the boat was tied to the tree at the bank, nobody untied this rope. This rope of ignorance is there. And you keep on rowing, perspiring. What you will get? You must know how to work. And then you work properly, with wisdom, understanding what the path is, understanding what the technique is. Yes, you will reach the final goal. Otherwise, all your efforts will go waste. Virya. And third important friend is sati, awareness. Awareness. Now, sati has got two meanings, this word. One meaning of the word sati, smriti, is memory. People take that meaning sometimes. Memory, and you start remembering. Memory of the past is not the technique of liberation. Sati, the another meaning of sati is awareness. And awareness is always of the present moment. You can't be aware of the past. You can have memory of that. You can't be aware of the future. You can just be thinking of that. But you can't be aware of it. Awareness should always be and can always be for the present moment, from moment to moment. Whatever you experience, you are aware of it. Whatever you experience, you are aware of it. Aware at the surface level and aware at the depth level. When you work with the sensation, you are aware at the depth level. And as well as where you are walking, you are aware of walking. You are aware of eating, but at the same time, you are aware of your own sensations. If that is missing, then it won't take you to the final goal. You may be very well aware of your walking. You get a wonderful faculty to remain alert about all your activities, but it won't take you to the final goal of liberation if you are missing sensation. I give example of a circus girl. She is walking on a tight rope and so much aware of every step. If she is not aware, she may fall down, break one of her limbs, or she may even die. So every step she is so aware, but she cannot become an arahant. She cannot become fully liberated because the sensation, she doesn't know what sensation is, and she doesn't know how to remain equanimous with the sensation. Or a dancing girl on the stage, aware of every step, every action, and yet no sensation. That doesn't take us to the final goal. Sensation is the teaching of Buddha. When you work with the sensation, you are aware of the sensation, you understand its nature of anicca, and with that understanding you maintain equanimity, then you are on the path of liberation, because this is how you change the habit pattern of your mind at the deepest level. Otherwise, you are working just with the surface level of the mind. So sati must be proper sati with proper wisdom, understanding what the sati is, and then accordingly you work with sati, you reach the final goal. And then samadhi. Again, samadhi must be samma samadhi, right type of samadhi. Understanding must be proper. What samadhi is? Mere concentration does not work. Kusal chittasya ekagata. The concentration must be of a pure mind. That means the base must be free from ignorance. If you have got an imaginary object, and with the help of this imaginary object you concentrate your mind, it is not samma samadhi. Or at the base of the mind you have got craving, you want something. By this samadhi, I'll gain this, I'll gain that. Doesn't work. Or your aversion at the base, doesn't work. Free from craving, free from aversion, free from imagination. The object that you are experiencing from moment to moment, you are sati, from moment to moment, how long you continue to be aware of the reality, from moment to moment, this is your real samadhi. And the fifth friend, panya, wisdom, upekha, equanimity. Very important. Again, if this panya, this wisdom is merely at the intellectual level, or merely whatever you heard or whatever you read, sutmaya panya or chintamaya panya, it doesn't work. It must be bhavanamaya panya. That is the contribution of Buddha to the human world. Bhavanamaya panya. You have to experience the wisdom at the level of your sensations. Then it is real panya. Equanimity at the level of sensations is your direct experience, and equanimity, wisdom, that keeps you free from craving, free from aversion at the deepest level of the mind. This is what you started doing here. This is what you have to practice in your life. Daily practice, you are with the sensations, and that you are not reacting with craving, you are not reacting with aversion. You keep on understanding this is anicca, and your mind becomes equanimous. Then you find how this equanimity has started manifesting itself in your day-to-day life. It must manifest. If you have just accepted anicca, if you have just accepted equanimity only at the intellectual level or devotional level, you can't expect it to manifest in your day-to-day life. Ups and downs in the life are bound to be there. Vicissitudes are bound to be there. How to deal with equanimity to all the situations in our day-to-day life? Then yes, the panya is real panya. Again, a story in our country. A very rich person at the old age died. And according to the custom there, his two sons started living in a joint family. For some time they continued in joint family, and later on some misunderstanding arose, they started quarreling, and then they divided the whole property, the money, jewelry, land, everything divided half. When everything was divided, Somebody found out a small packet hidden somewhere. They took it out, what it is. And they found that it contained two rings. One was the ordinary silver ring. Other was a ring studded with very valuable diamond. The elder brother developed some greed. And he tried to explain the younger one. To me it looks, this is not the earning of our father. This is, most probably, it is coming from generations. And therefore it should go for generations. I being elder, I better keep it so that it goes for generation. If we sell it and divide the money, we will lose it. So I better keep it. You better keep the silver one. The younger brother smiled. All right, be happy. You be happy with the diamond one. I'll be happy with the silver one. And they started their life. Ups and downs are coming. The elder brother with the diamond ring. When there is spring in the life, he gets so elated. So elated. And when spring goes away, and there is winter or autumn, he becomes so depressed. So depressed. Always losing the balance of the mind. With everything he faces in the world, loses the balance of the mind. Loses the balance of the mind. Tension, hypertension. This tranquilizer, that tranquilizer. A super tranquilizer. A sleeping pill, a super sleeping pill. And then it came to the stage where electric shocks were given. This is the brother with the diamond ring. The other brother with ordinary silver ring. He started thinking, my father kept very secure this valuable diamond ring, it is understandable. Why this ordinary silver ring? There must be some meaning, some purpose for that. And he started examining it. And he found something was inscribed on it. And he read, what is inscribed? And it was inscribed on it, this will also change. Oh, this will also change. This is the teaching of my father. This will also change. Everything changes. And he had this ring on his little finger. Spring comes. He enjoys. He doesn't run away from that. He enjoys spring. And looking at this finger, yes, this will also change. This is not eternal. And when it passes away, he smiles. I knew this was going to change. It has changed. So what? I don't care. He doesn't lose the balance of the mind. When winter comes, again his ring. This will also change. He doesn't cry. He doesn't feel depressed. This will also change. Law of nature is such. It has to change. Ups and downs are bound to come in the life. Vicissitudes are bound to come in the life. If we keep on understanding this will also change, this will also change. Not necessary to look at the ring. The ring inside, the reality inside. We have got that inheritance from the Buddha. Observe this reality inside, this will change. A very painful experience is there. Oh, this will change. A very pleasant flow is there. Oh, this will change. And this change is there, certainly. You are experiencing. Whatever the truth you are experiencing inside, the same truth gets manifested outside. This will change. This will change. And you maintain perfect equanimity of your mind. Then this friend is a very good friend for you. All these five friends are wonderful friends. Don't worry about the enemies. No enemy can harm you. You keep these five friends with you and keep them pure, no pollution, with the wisdom, understanding how to make use of these friends. And you will find step by step, you are moving towards the final goal. These 2 days of serious meditation are days of real serious meditation. See that you maintain the continuity. Day and night, only when you are in deep sleep. Otherwise, day and night, nothing to do with other students. Carry on your own. Carry on your own. Make very deep operation, surgical operation of the mind. Take out very deep-rooted complexes and get liberated. As many complexes you take out, that much liberation is there. Liberation from the miseries. Life is full of misery because the life is full of these defilements, mental defilements. Come out of them and enjoy real peace, real harmony, real happiness. May all of you enjoy real peace, real harmony, real happiness, real happiness. Sarva Mangalam. Take rest for about 5 minutes and then again start working. Take rest for about 5 minutes.